official child avalanche? Was last week official? I don't know. Last week was official. That's what I've been told. So, thanks everybody for coming out. This is fun. I guess we'll go ahead and just dive right in. I don't think we have announcements for child av stuff. No, we'll get to it later if I think of anything. So, I'm going to dive into this. This is kind of an interesting topic because Zebra's really distracting. It's fun. It's kind of a complicated topic, so feel free to ask a lot of questions. If I start to go too fast or anything, let me know. So this whole story kind of started when I was a kid, and I wanted to make games. Like, I was like, I don't know, 12 or something, and I played a lot of Chrono Trigger, and I was like, this game is awesome. Played a lot of like Ocarina of Time, and I wanted to play games, and I wanted to make games. Because it wasn't enough just to kind of play the game. I wanted to actually be like a creator of something. So in my mind, when I thought about what it would be like to make games, I thought it would look a lot like this. This is one of the more awesome images of like that era. Did anybody actually ever, I've never seen this book in real life, but if somebody has a copy, I'd love to actually read it. Turns out what I more looked like was something like that. I wrote C++ in Notepad on Windows, and I didn't know how to install anything. So I didn't really know how DirectX worked, but everybody was like, you've got to know how to use DirectX. Essentially, I got nothing done, which really, really sucked because it's incredibly discouraging to want to do something and not be able to do it. But I listened to my good buddy Steve. Steve said, real artists ship. And that kind of resonated with me because it meant that what was important wasn't how I did something, but it was just doing it. So I found this thing. Did anybody else ever have this?
Yes.
This was like my favorite thing. This is, for those who don't know, this is RPG Maker. And what it allowed you to do is you could take all these sprites and just drop them into the grid, and then you can add game logic to them. And it was awesome. It like had a built-in fighting system, and like I could make Chrono Trigger in this, albeit a kind of worse version. And when I found this, I felt like this. I was like, I have unlocked the secrets of computers. So I showed all my friends, and I showed people on the internet, and I got a really funny response. This is ridiculous. Like, I don't want to write C++. I don't like C++. C++ isn't fun for me. I just want to build cool games. This is a thing that we say to each other a lot to this day, right? So, talk about Go versus Python, or Python versus Ruby, or Java versus Ruby, or Node versus IOJS. People write, I am leaving you letters for languages. Like, this is absolutely ridiculous. We have gotten so entrenched in these sort of, like, ideas about tools, and it's exploded. So we're going to talk about that ridiculousness here in a bit. But first, I want to talk about this guy. Who knows who this guy is?
Turing.
It's Turing, which you should probably have been able to figure out from the title of the talk. Turing, for those of you who don't know, was a, I don't know, arguably the largest contributor to computer science. I mean, it depends on how you want to, like, chop that up, but incredibly, incredibly smart, did all kinds of foundational work for the stuff that we do today. And he was trying to solve a problem. He wanted to build a computer. And when we think about computers, we think about this thing, but that wasn't what he was thinking about. He wasn't even really thinking about this thing. This thing was way in the future from what he was building. He hadn't even thought about this yet. For those of you who don't know, does anybody know what that is? That's the ENIAC. Yeah, that's the ENIAC. I think it's funny that, not funny actually, but kind of sad and ironic that in both of these images, the people using computers are women. And that one as well. So, but that's not what he was trying to solve. Back when Turing was trying to solve this problem in the 30s, a computer wasn't a device. A computer was a human being, predominantly women. A human would actually sit and compute numbers and do all sorts of like really complicated math. And that's how computers worked. But Turing wanted to build something better. He wanted to build an automatic computer, something that could actually understand and do math on its own. And so in a very seminal paper, he developed what we now refer to as a Turing machine. This is a really, really simple machine. This is not a machine that actually existed in real life. This was a thought experiment that he kind of put forth in that paper. And it did some really simple things. His machine was a strip of tape that you could write numbers on, those numbers being 1 and 0, a tape head so that you could actually read from the tape, and also the ability to write to the tape, and an internal set of state and rules. So when I say finite state machine, does everybody understand what I mean? Okay, so it's a set of rules. At each given state, you can go one direction or the other based on input. So that was his whole thing. And he took other sort of like automata and kind of expounded upon it by removing a stack and giving it this like strip of tape, which you can kind of think of as an infinite array that you can push then pop things onto from either side. So infinitely expanding. These Turing machines also had some really simple operations. They could read input data, they could write on the current cell, so where the tape head was at on the tape. They can change their internal state, and they could move left or right. So to give you an idea of what something like that would have looked like for instance, if you wanted to add a number, you would start with some input, for instance, 1011, and we want to increment this number. So the brackets kind of denote like where the tape head is at, and we have some pretty simple rules. So we write 0 and we move left. We write 0 and we move left because we both have a 1. We're in state 1 and we have a 1 as an input. We move again and we see that we have a 0. So now we know that our action is to write 1, it's to move right, and it's to go to state 2. So now we're in state 2. We see a 0, so we move right. We see a 0, so we move right. And we see nothing else. So now we move back just to the left and we're in state 3, which is the accept state, and basically means our operation is done. We now incremented a number. Oops, I hit the wrong button. Now we're done. So, and that's it. That's a Turing machine. That's how a Turing machine worked. It's interesting that these machines are deterministic, which means that at any given place, based on any input and based on the state that you're in, there's one rule that takes place. And these simple machines can actually be used to do anything. Well, not anything. There are some exceptions to that rule. But by and large, you can explain most computations that you want to do with this machine. And Turing built his as a thought experiment. Years and years and years later, somebody actually built one. And I just found this. And I think it's like the coolest thing. Why aren't you playing? No. What's happening here? Oh, it doesn't like my, hang on. Doesn't like my speaker notes. So there's actually a voiceover to this, which is like kind of actually just more annoying than anything. But that was like very on cue. But you can see what's happening here, right? It's moving the tape. It's writing numbers. It's examining at the tape head. And it's figuring out what it needs to do. So it's going to erase that one. It's going to write a new number there. And that is a physical manifestation of Turing's thought experiment. That is pretty freaking cool. And apparently this is in kit form and you can build it. And I really, really want to. Yeah, that's a lot of tape. I don't know, it's not cheap. I'm pretty sure. They don't say a price. In any case.
Disaster.
Yeah. But there is a problem with this. And that first problem is that rules are built directly into this machine. This machine has to be programmed ahead of time with a certain set of rules about state and input to know what it's going to do. So if we built an adder or an incrementer, let's say, that Turing machine can only ever be an incrementer. So what we really want is not a Turing machine. We really want a machine that can read in lots of Turing machines and then emulate all of those Turing machines. So basically we need a Turing machine for Turing machines. So basically we need this. So what we actually are talking about here is a universal Turing machine. And that's what we do. We just, because a Turing machine can essentially compute any sort of computation, we can build a Turing machine that understands other Turing machines' rules. And then we feed it Turing machines. So, and it works. That's mind-blowingly cool, in my opinion. Maybe that just makes me a huge nerd. But this is awesome because we can now treat, this is essentially computers, right? Computers are this, right? My computer here is a universal Turing machine, and programming languages are Turing machines, which means I can feed my universal Turing machine a Turing machine, and it knows what to do. The other implication of this that's really very profound is that anything you can do in one language, you can do in another, assuming it is Turing complete. So that's very, very cool. There's another slight problem, though, sort of. Because a Turing machine can emulate other Turing machines, it can emulate other things, it actually means that any enhancement you could make to a Turing machine can, in fact, be simulated by a Turing machine. So what this effectively means is that a Turing machine is as powerful of a computing device as we get. Right? Like, you can replace a tape head with RAM and with registers, and you can make it faster, but that's just sort of like, that's not making it more powerful, right? You've just decreased the amount of time it takes to do any certain given thing. So basically that. We don't have any enhancement that we actually have to a Turing machine that we can come up with, a Turing machine can emulate, including non-deterministic Turing machines, because a Turing machine can emulate non-determinism, and basically, you don't get any ability to increase speed, or excuse me, increase power. You get a lot of ability to increase speed. This also has implications because it means that programming languages have the exact same limits. Programming languages themselves are limited by the fact that everything is Turing complete. Because you know, you can't actually make this thing more powerful. If you could, then you would have broken Turing completeness. So some people think it's like that, because that sucks, because now we're always limited to this base level thing, but I actually kind of think it's more like that, which is awesome. Like, this means that powerful, because power is not equal to useful, right? Just because everything is the same amount of powerful doesn't mean that everything is the same amount of useful. And languages can be designed to fit use cases and certain needs. So when Matt's, a personal hero of mine, wrote Ruby, he said, I hope to see Ruby help every programmer in the world to be productive and to enjoy programming and to be happy. That is the primary purpose of the Ruby language. Larry Wall famously said, easy things should be easy and hard things should be possible. That was the point of Perl. Steve Jobs said, real artists ship. And actually what's funny is he stole that line from this guy, Andy Warhol. And he said, making money is art and working is art and good business is the best art. Which means that all of the arguments about languages like Go versus Python and Python versus Ruby and Java versus Ruby and Node versus IOJS are all bullshit, because it's about using what you love. It's about building sweet software that you want to see in the world, and it's about sharing it with other people. Thanks. So I have a lot of time for questions.
Does quantum computing hold the same Turing?
Yes.
Yes. There are quantum computing machines. Once again, it's faster.
It's a lot faster, but you're not more powerful. Because again, it's like we can add persistent storage, we could add subroutines and all this other stuff to a Turing machine, but all that can be emulated by a Turing machine, which means it's not more powerful than a Turing machine.
One of the projects, the limit was, it's kind of like the ENIAC or whatever, where it only had kind of one purpose, so it had limited function, and it was only designed around those functions.
Sure.
I feel like that one computer that's in use now at Google only does basically one thing left. You know what I mean?
Sure, yeah, totally. Well, and then we see that in language design, right? Like, a really good use case for this is like, Erlang, right? Like Erlang's really good at a certain subset of problems. You know, Ruby's good at a certain subset of problems and not good at other things. And like that's where the usefulness stuff comes in. But yeah, at the end of the day, it all goes back to Turing. So. Anybody else have questions? Yes.
How is it true that the language is trained completely? It's not true, like, middle expressions are language.
How do you know who to use? What are all based on Alice 46 permutants? Like, every language needs those requirements. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a regex is not Turing complete, and other like there's other like pushdown automata that aren't Turing complete. In terms of like actually proving it, you need math, and like I'm not much with the math. it's a general rule of like if you can like. I think it's like if you can loop and if you can yeah. like you have like conditionals. Yeah. If you can do loops. Yeah, that's more or less the barometer. But depends. There's actual math behind it. And I mean if you go look at it at the paper, like he didn't just explain it like succinctly. I mean he does explain it succinctly, but he also uses all this math and like girl numbering and stuff and it's more complicated.
Do you think that there's still a debate to be had about the usefulness for n domains than for different languages? Is your ire towards people saying that you can't do something in a particular language, or that somebody might say this language is more useful for the particular domain than somebody's?
I think the language that is useful is the language that's useful to your organization and to you. Like, what's the language that you get stuff done in? And what's the language that you like? Because if you're happy, you're going to be productive. And if you're productive, you're going to ship. And real artists ship. And like, if you like PHP, write PHP. Like, I don't personally like PHP, so I'm not going to. I don't like Java, I'm not gonna write Java, but I like other things, you know. I like things that other people don't. I don't know, I don't find those arguments to be that fulfilling because they're largely based on you and your organization. You should use the job that you should use the tool that you like
yeah,
for that job.
Criteria is Turing completeness. Everything else is subjective. It's all about.
Yeah, I mean, it's all about yeah. Lots of stuff is built on stuff that shouldn't have been built on that stuff, right? Like, yeah, for sure.
Is there any sign or hints of a post-Turing world?
I think it's Idris is a new language that's doing some interesting things, but like it goes back to this problem of any Turing machine can emulate any enhancement that we can come up with it. So if you could somehow come up with an enhancement that a Turing machine couldn't actually fulfill, then we would live in a world that had more than Turing completeness. But like the lambda calculus like is Turing equivalent, right? So like even like ridiculous things that should not be related are. It's kind of a weird world that we live in.
That's what I guess the concept of quantum computing is that you have multiple heads.
Yeah, but so like
you could emulate that by running sequentially multiple head operations on.
Yeah, and I mean, people have talked forever about like adding multiple tapes to a Turing machine. Like, what would that do if you could add like multiple tapes and actually, you know, and again, it's just like a Turing machine can actually emulate that. So if it can emulate it, then it's Turing complete, and it means that it's.
Yeah, so Turing complete is something fast. So yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
The thing with quantum computing is like it collapses the state of the solution to your problem. So it's like
otherwise you're doing that sequentially.
Yeah. Post Turing is like.
Yeah, it's not a lot different than swapping out a tape for RAM.
Yeah.
And like, you know, a Turing machine like moves left every time. Well, if you can randomly access any piece of memory, then you can go a lot faster.
Take out, like, a whole of speed.
Yeah, but that's well, but it's but
you're
moving
not,
left
you're
is
not moving fast, you're arriving at the correct
RAM. Yes.
So I'm not arguing that.
Totally. Yeah, yeah. No, it's analogous, right? Because there's no reason why you need to actually move left or right. That's just a convention to keep things simple.
you could randomly access whatever address that you wanted, which is how they arrived at RAM in the first place. So, any other questions and stuff?
I noticed it in like a quantum computing talk that keeps being brought up when I'm talking about posts, you know, and I don't know how much this discussion is about quantum computing, but what confuses me about quantum computing is the whole state machine thing where it's in both states at the same time, which kind of reminds me of like Schrodinger's cat or something.
That's actually what it should remind you of.
So I mean, when you get into quantum, that's just mind-boggling. I just can't keep that in mind.
It's essentially running multiple Turing machines in parallel is really what's more like than having two heads on one Turing machine, because you take divergent actions and you get the result that is the correct result for what you want. From whichever action creates the correct result. So it's like having how many ever states you have in your quantum computer, that's how many Turing machines you have. I mean,
Schrodinger's cat was actually like Schrodinger's answer to like weighted particle duality. Like, it was a joke. It was like,
oh, I understand.
Yeah, yeah. No. But I'm just saying, being in both states at one time. But we are dealing with quantum mechanics.
Yeah. So yeah, I mean, I think there's a whole discussion about like.
So about that physics meetup.
Yeah, I know. For sure. I think there's a lot of interesting discussion about there's the whole notion of the Turing tarpit, right? Like, if everything's complete, then it doesn't matter. Well, we could all write Befunge, and like that's like the new hot asynchronous JavaScript framework is actually written in Befunge or something. Like, I don't know. Like you could do that. It's not useful. Like, so, usefulness is up to you.
You end up with completely different measures of which language you should use. Like, how many lines does it take you to accomplish a given task? Like, that's very, very
difficult. Yeah.
Just a library, like.
Well, and we talk a lot about like performance and like, I don't know, how much do you? If we cared about performance, we'd all write C, right? Like, I don't know. Like, so where do you draw the line? It's all subjective. Or we, yeah.
There's two states. Objective, is it Turing complete? Subjective, do you want to use it?
Yeah, it's for sure. So.
What do you do about the halting problem?
Oh yeah, the halting problem. Yeah.
So when you said Turing completeness.
This goes back to like implementation stuff. I don't know, like that's a whole other political discussion about, you know, I could sit up here and like give you my opinion. I don't know how much.
That'd be like copyright with art. Is all pencil art not copyrightable because it was made with a pencil?
No.
Come back. So, same thing. I mean, the software as an art, and don't give your art an opinion, software patents, but that'd be the same.
I think you've got stronger arguments. I think you've got stronger arguments. Maybe my question.
You copyright the process. You copyright the actual code, and if you want to copyright it,
all right. Pedantic. Like.
I'm clarifying. So like you patent the process. You copyright actual code base, and you copyright it under the same law that you would copyright a book under. Right. And in fact, that in some cases they ask you to ship a paper copy that's been redacted up to 70%.
It's funny. I think you've got stronger arguments in against software patents than Turing completeness, but it is interesting. I'll say that. So that's pretty much all I have. We still have a lot of time because I went through that faster than I thought I was going to. But lightning talks. Jesus, we don't have that much time. I don't get shown up already. Like it's first talk. I know it's a train wreck. Anyway, if you want to talk more about this stuff, which I kind of like to go on and on about, come find me and we'll talk more about it. Maybe we'll get a beer. That'd be fun. Other than that, So we're back to every week now. So I guess we'll do announcements. We're back to every week. We'll be here next week.